Do you know that PMI ACP exam has around 10 to 15 questions from the chapter Planning, Monitoring and Adapting? Yes, you heard it right. 10 to 15 questions out of the total 120 questions that we see on the exam. So this makes Planning, Monitoring and Adapting chapter as one of the most important chapters in your PMI ACP exam preparation. Okay, and honestly speaking, when I was studying for my exam, I could not find any video which effectively explained the concepts of planning, monitoring and adapting on PMI ACP for PMI ACP exam, and that's why I have put together this video to help you, to support you in your preparation for the PMI ACP. So let's get started. So we are going to talk about planning, monitoring, adapting overview, details about planning, monitoring, adapting, how it compares with the traditional methodologies or non-agile environment, some planning initiation artifacts and tools and techniques. And we have divided this whole chapter under various modules. So you will see some of these topics being covered in the subsequent videos. So let's get started with the overview of planning, monitoring, and adapting. Agile planning. So let's get started with some planning. And why don't we take up a real example, real life example? Supposedly you are getting married maybe 4 months down the line, okay, and you want to plan your wedding. Yes, you want your wedding to be perfect and you want to plan for your wedding. What would you do? At a very high level, you will decide as what all things to be done. Maybe you will say, okay, instead of going into details, you will just say, I want to finalize on venue. I want to block the venue. I want to block the caterer. I want to block the decorations. I want to decide on the menu, or maybe menu is part of caterer. Okay. And then, yes, shopping. Shopping for dresses, costumes, dresses. Maybe gifts. Okay, so maybe you want a orchestra, band. Okay, so you want to plan your wedding, which is 4 months down the line, and at a very high level you have decided, broken down into various components. One is venue, caterer, decorations, band and some shopping. Okay, so what would you do? 4 months. I think the most important thing right now is to fix on the venue and the caterer, because that is a peak time. There are a lot of weddings happen during that time, and I want to ensure that the venue of my choice is blocked. So what I do this 4 months, I divide among one month. The first month, the goal of first month is venue and caterer. See, menu part can come later on, but here I just want to finalize and block. Further, I divide this 1 month into two sprints. So I am going to conduct it in an agile manner, and agile is about iterations, progressive elaboration and taking things one small chunk at a time and delivering value. So my first sprint, which is of 2 weeks, I am going to decide on the venue. In the next sprint, I am going to decide on the caterer. And to in order to be able to decide on that, I have to do some research. Okay, I have to analyze various options available. Okay, maybe I have to gather some feedback from others who have used those venues earlier. Okay, and based on the feedback, I have to, of course, budgeting, right? So based on several factors which are there under my research, I will decide on the venue and I will block it. Of course, availability is another factor. Availability of the dates. If the dates are fixed, then your venue should be available, right? So my first iteration or my first sprint is the the iterations used in Scrum methodology is known as sprint, and in general you will call them iterations. Okay, so my first sprint of 2 weeks, I have decided on the venue. I have done all the required research, I have done the analysis, I have taken feedbacks, I have handled costing, I have checked on availability, and I have decided on the venue. Next come the caterer. So the second sprint, I am planning to take up the caterer. So what we did is, at a very high level, just when we decided on our wedding date, we created a plan as to what I am going to achieve in each month. Every month comprised of two sprints. Okay, you can call them these months as releases. Okay, so these were releases. And every release, so R1, R2, R3, and R4. And R4 is our wedding. End of R4 is our wedding. Every release, I divided it into two sprints. Okay. And I decided at a high level what I target to do in this release. So my first release was focused on finalizing of venue and caterer. Okay, so that is planning under Agile, planning iteratively, planning in Agile environment. So what is Agile planning? Project planning to ensure the project is going in the right direction. I want no surprises on my wedding day. So I want to plan it properly so that things happen. I want to take up one thing at a time and work on it. Okay. Team picks up and delivers the most valuable items as per their capacity. And purpose, steer the product in the right direction while avoiding team burnout. Okay. I don't want to be overwhelmed with the situation towards the end. I want to take care of things beforehand. That is why I plan. Okay. But there is a difference between planning in Agile and planning in Waterfall, which we are going to see in the upcoming slides, in the upcoming discussion. Okay. So planning, releases and iterations are planned to ensure that they comply with the product vision and product roadmap. Okay, so we have a product vision in place where I want my product to go, which direction I want my product to go. What is the revenues I am expecting? Of course, any product, any business you do, the end of the day, you want to see benefits out of it. That's why you are doing something, right? You want to see revenue. You want to see your revenue going up, right? And that is why planning iteratively helps us to stay on top of the market, because these are the points where we are inspecting, checking for things, and we are adapting, which means I am always working on the most valuable item. Okay, going back to the wedding example, let's say you straight away started with shopping. Okay, you thought, okay, shopping is the best thing. But when you were discussing, you realize that maybe if you don't block on venue and caterer now, later it will be too late. So the most valuable thing to start with was blocking on venue and caterer, right? So you changed your plan, or you, while planning, you thought about, okay, this is the item which will bring most value and should be done first. Okay, so we will introduce you another concept later on, which is last responsible moment, which talks about you need to delay the decisions till they can, not after that. What if you started working on venue just in the last sprint, 15 days before your wedding? Do you think you will have the venue? Maybe, or maybe you have to just pick out of the whatever choices are available to you at that time, right? So you really do not have lot of say in picking, you know, which venue you want for your wedding. Maybe there are only two options available. Maybe there is only one option available and you have to live with the choice. You don't want that. That is why planning helps us to move the product towards the direction, okay, in the right direction. So how do we do that? How do we do that? So we first identify at a high level what all things to be done. Okay, then we identify how much work we can do. Okay, based on my time commitments, my schedule, I can see that, okay, in a 2-week sprint, I can do only this much work. And based on that, I decide, yes, I'm going to focus only one thing in this sprint, in my first sprint. Okay, so things to be done, we have listed down. Then how much we can work, we can take up based on our capacity. Okay, so how, and based on that, we pick the items, we plan for the work. Okay, we pick the most valuable work, something which provides the highest value to the customer or highest value to the project in hand. Okay, so how much we have to do? We have the whole list of things to be done, whole list. Okay, and then we see how fast we are going or how much we can do. Okay, this is known as team velocity. Team velocity is, you know, velocity, you know, it's the speed in a particular direction, right? So speed, and team velocity is team's speed, which is how many story points or how much work can be done by the team in a single iteration. Okay, so team velocity is how much work can be done by team in one iteration. Okay, and as we will see later on in our other subsequent chapters, this work is measured through relative sizing, and the unit we use is story points. We are not going to get into detail here about story points. I would encourage you to go and listen to the video on estimations, which covers relative sizing and story points in detail. Okay, so team velocity is the number of story points covered by the team in one iteration. Velocity is covered in detail in metrics chapter. Go ahead and listen to the video on metrics. Okay, so based on how fast we are going, how much work we have to do, we can plan, you know, when we expect to be done, when we will be able to finish. So measure the speed with which a team can turn user stories into working production ready software, and then use that to figure out when it will be done. Example. So this is how much we have to do. We are going to talk about it in subsequent slides, but for the simplicity's sake, you just think that this is called product backlog. Okay, but we have upcoming videos in which we are going to talk about it. So product backlog is the how much we have to do. Okay. So, and let's say product backlog has a total of 160 story points. Total, cumulative. Okay. Team can do 16 story points in one iteration. Okay. 16 story points in one iteration. So that means to complete 160 total story points worth of work in product backlog, the team needs 10 iterations. Okay. So that's how you plan for the work. What is monitoring? Yes, it is exactly what it is. Monitoring, inspecting, checking. Everything is okay or not, right? So we planned for it. We executed certain things. Okay, we blocked our venue here. In the next sprint, we blocked our caterer here. And then you inspect that, you know, everything is done here or not. Okay, so while before blocking, you inspect at that time. Okay, you analyze the whatever feedbacks you have received for different venues. What is it that you want? Which venues have those options? What is the feedback? What is other people's experience? So you inspect. And you have decided on maybe two options, and then you see, okay, which is better, okay? And finally, you visit the venue and check it yourself. Is this the right one for me? That's what monitoring is, okay? It involves is inspection of the work. Have I actually blocked it? Is the, venue person, or the department, have they blocked their calendars? Do I have a confirmation email? Okay. Maybe you need to pay some amount to block it. Is it done? Has it been withdrawn from the account? So inspection for the work, processes, and values at each level. We will talk about it in subsequent release, iteration, and daily. So hold on to your question till we reach the release, iteration, daily planning part in this same video. So monitoring in waterfall or non-agile, that focused on deviations and bringing the project back to original baseline. Okay, in waterfall, what happens? A very, this is the requirement gathering phase. This is the analysis and design phase. This is the development phase, testing. Okay, and then maybe handover. So a very heavy upfront, requirement analysis phase, requirement gathering, analysis and design phase was done. Okay, and then a plan. I missed the plan part here, and it is not this small, okay? So a plan was created to deliver each and every item upfront, which means the plan is fixed, okay? We regularly here, we are monitoring, okay? And we are checking how much deviations we have made from the original plan, which means we don't have flexibility to introduce any last minute changes. Maybe the customer thinks that something else is more important. Maybe a new technology has come out. Maybe a new standard has come out and the customer wants to focus the efforts towards the new standard, right? But would you be able to do that in waterfall? No, because your plan is fixed. We are not flexible, right? Unless and until you go through the whole change control board, the whole change control process. where you prepare for all the impacts, you give the presentation in front of the change control board, answer their queries. Maybe you have to go back and do some more research and then get back. Once you get the approval, only then it happens. And this is a very long and lot of effort is needed. Okay, so we handle changes in Agile. There is effort needed in that as well, but it is not as big as, in Waterfall or non-Agile. In Agile, it focuses on inspection for value and processes, not for really the deviations from the original plan. No, because we are doing it in iterations. So we check right then and there. Okay. And if customer wants something else, maybe we were going on the right path, but he thinks this is the better. So we can change the course. We can do that. Okay. So what is Agile adaptation? It is when the team makes changes to the product, service, process, project to maximize the value. Okay. Adaptation. Just like the name says, adapt as per the surroundings. That's what is good at. Yes. So look at the surroundings and adapt as per it. Okay. If the market demands certain things to be done, adapt as per those changes. Okay. Remember the camera roles. We used to have roles. We didn't know how the picture is clicked. Once we developed, then we realized, oh, this was not good. Maybe the settings were not right and all the pictures are blurry and you have lost that moment. And then the digital wave came in. Now you click the picture, you see how it is, you click it again, right? So adapt as per the market. That's what. And if you fail to adapt, you are doomed to failure. Okay. Remember, we don't want to fail. Okay. So adapt as per, keep a watch on the market, keep a watch on your competition, on the latest trends that is happening, and adapt your project as per the requirement which will bring us the maximum value. Maximum value. Maybe it is a financial value which businesses would like to have. Maybe it is the need of the hour. It has to be done. Okay. So process tailoring, continuous integration, user story change, retrospectives, continuous improvement. These are just example of the practices that we do towards adaptation. Okay. So we learn from the things that are happening and we implement those learnings. Okay. So when we implement learnings into the project, that is adaptation. Expect uncertainty and respond accordingly. Okay. So just like, if the surroundings are brown, the chameleon changes the color to brown. If it is green, changes the color to green, right? So expect uncertainty and respond accordingly rather than following outdated plans. Okay. We are not going to follow outdated plans. We plan for the work, immediate work. Okay. And for all the work, we do it at a very, very high level. We don't waste our time and effort into detailing out things in advance. If we know that the project is dynamic and we are expecting a lot of changes, please remember, Waterfall has its own advantages. Okay. But it really depends on project to project. For some project, Agile is best. For some project, Waterfall is best. And for this, you have to listen to our first video on introduction to Agile. Okay. Adapt processes and practices as needed by the project. Every project is unique. If you go to the PMBOK, you see the definition of project. It says it is a unique endeavor. Okay? So, if a project is unique, then process and practices should be taken up as per the needs of that project. Okay? So, that's what adaptation is about. So let's get started with planning in detail. No, we are not doing planning in detail upfront. This is just telling what are the details of the planning. Okay, how do we do? What, when we do? Which all levels are there? That's what we are going to talk about, you know, planning details. So, till now, we have got some understanding about how planning is done in Agile and how it is done in Waterfall. Waterfall, we already know. It's a heavy upfront planning that was done, right? Heavy upfront planning. What we were doing? Actually, we had all the requirements from the customer. So, and we had a sign off from the customer that these are the requirements and no other requirement. And a very big document was prepared, exhaustive with all the requirements, which the customer signed off. And then we created a plan taking those requirements. What we did, we first created a WBS, which is work breakdown structure. We estimated this and MPP was created with detailed, you know, features, tasks, resources, who's going to do, dependencies taken care of, and which particular item is going to be done or from which date to which date. So a very detailed plan was made with for all the requirements. Maybe even if the whole delivery took 1 year or more than 1 year, everything from day to day for every date was put down on paper. By paper, I meant put down into writing. Okay. You can say this was cast in stone. And you know what happens when you have cast something in stone, you really can't change it so easily. It's not easy. That's what the waterfall does with the planning. Okay. The focus is on following the plan with minimal changes. So in waterfall, focus is on following the plan with minimal changes. Then what about Agile? In Agile, focus is on adapting to the inevitable changes. Okay. We know at the beginning of the project, there is less information available. There is less clarity. Okay. And uncertainty is pretty high. Right? So if uncertainty is high, information is less, clarity is less, then how can we plan for all this? At the beginning, right? Not possible. That is why agile teams, they welcome change. They embrace change. What is the need of the hour for that project? They welcome those changes and they adapt to those changes willingly. Okay. Iterative planning and progressive elaboration. So agile teams plan iteratively. Okay. Agile teams plan iteratively and with each iteration, they elaborate their plans. So what we did? We did a very high level plan. We just decided on the four things. Okay. This is what I'm going to focus on in each release or in each month. Remember the wedding? We decided on what to focus on in which month. And then we divided it later. So when we actually get into that release, that time I decided, okay, this is going to be my two sprints here. And this is the focus of my first sprint. This is the focus of my second sprint, right? So we progressively elaborate about things. Okay, these concepts are very specific to Agile, and I would like you to pay special attention here. So Agile plans, they are done just in time, okay? Not early and not late. Here I would also like to tell, just in time is also last responsible moment. A moment which is the last responsible. Beyond this, if you go, it is too late. Okay, you don't want to plan for your sprint after the sprint is over. Does it make sense? No. So you don't want to plan for your dresses after your wedding is over. No. Or the example we took, you started planning for venue just 15 days before the wedding. And by this time, all the venues are already blocked. They were not available. Was that the right approach? No, right? So you plan for things at the last responsible moment. Okay, so you decided that maybe venue was the first thing because they go very fast. So many weddings are happening. This is the season of the wedding. Okay, so many weddings are happening. So you plan for it first. And when you are actually working on venue, when you are actually going to do the analysis, that time you decide what all things you have to do under this. You just decided initially that, okay, my first sprint is going to focus on venue. Then when you started planning for it, at that time you decided, okay, I need to do analysis. I need to do some research. I need to take feedback from people. I need to visit venue. All those things that you decided just before you started working on it. Okay. So agile plans are done just in time. And they are just good enough. Means no lengthy plans. Okay. No effort that you are going to waste on doing something which is not going to be used. Okay. They are just good enough. You don't plan in advance. You plan just in time. And your plans are just good enough with which you can start the work. Okay. So that is just good enough. Another word for it is just barely sufficient. You will see these words, just barely sufficient. Okay. They are collaborative, means the whole team plans together. It's not one person's job. It is not only the project manager and the team lead or solution architect to prepare plans and push it to people and tell them to do the things. No, the team plans for the work together. Okay, it is a collaborative effort. Everybody, the whole team works, agile teams, they take the whole team together. Okay, everything is collaborative in agile. Continuous, it's a continuous process. So we planned at high level for the release. And when we came to the sprints level, we plan for those sprints at that time. Okay, so it's a continuous effort. It's incremental. Our plans get built on top of each other. So this was my plan for sprint one. Then comes the plan for sprint two. And now after sprint two, I see that this was the plan that was done. Sprint three adds on to another thing. Incremental, iteratively, it is done in cycles. Every sprint has its own planning. Every iteration has its own planning. Progressively elaborated, high level, venue, okay, caterer, and maybe under caterer, I plan for, I elaborated further. How? Maybe I want to have some, focus on desserts. Oh, I start with desserts. Please pardon me. I am a sweet person. No, I like sweets. So yes, caterer, desserts and appetizers, main course, soups, maybe some other things that you want, drinks. Okay, so you plan for them when the time comes to decide about it. Okay, first focus was just on caterer, then your menu comes. Okay, so planning is done at a portfolio level. Okay, overall portfolio, what all, it's the strategy, overall strategy that your organization wants to see. At product level, the vision of the product, what is the direction that your product should be taking. Okay, based on this vision, this is the roadmap we create here. Okay, we create product roadmap here. Okay, and we, based on this roadmap, we decide on the releases. So we do release planning here. Once our vision is clear, we have made our roadmap, we do the planning for that particular release, which means what all things are going to be delivered as part of release backlog. Yes, this is another topic which is covered in a different video. I would encourage you to go and listen to our videos on backlogs. Okay, so release backlog is created, which means what all user stories or functionalities would be delivered as part of this release. And what is release comprises of? Iterations. Yes, so I plan for iteration. So when I'm planning for that specific iteration is when I'm creating iteration or sprint backlog. And we don't just stop here, we plan on a daily basis. Yes, daily stand up is another way of, planning daily, planning on the go. Take an example. John says, I am going to work on module X tomorrow. Nancy says, no, I have the, I have dependency on module Y and my work will be finished in 2 days. Why don't you pick up Y so that, when my, this thing is, my current work is finished, I can, I am deblocked, you can say. I don't have to wait for it. Or maybe Y is done, then, I can proceed smoothly. And John says, yeah, why not? I can work on Y instead. So this is planning on the go. Okay, planning on a daily level. And that is possible through daily stand up. In fact, we de-risk the project on a daily level, which we are going to talk about in our another video. Especially go ahead and listen to the videos on risk management. So, levels of planning. First, we create a product vision statement. Through the vision, we create roadmap, which gives us a high level overview of the direction the product is taking. So how many releases are there? Okay, R1, R2, R3, and how many sprints in each of these releases? Sprint 1, Sprint 2, Sprint 1, Sprint 2, 1 and 2. Of course, this is for release 2. Okay, so, and release planning, when you do, you create a release plan, you create a plan only for this part. Okay, only for this part. So what we did earlier, remember, we decided that we are going to do venue and caterer in my first release, which was my monthly release. Okay, in my next release, I'm going to decide on theme and decorations and band and some part of shopping. Okay, some part of shopping. I wanted to do it in R2. Remaining, I wanted to finish by R3. This was focused on shopping. Shopping for dresses, shopping for other materials. Okay, maybe a new home, who knows? So, when you went to the release level, release one, that time you decided what all things you want to do. And here you divided it. Okay, this is going to be my sprint one focus. This is going to be my sprint two focus. And when you went to the iteration planning level at sprint one, you decided which all things you will need to do to finalize on venue. So at that plan, you decided, okay, in order to finalize venue, what I need to do? I need to get a list of all the venues, okay? Procure a list, prepare a list of my and my partner's likings, what we are looking for in the venue, what do we want? Maybe we want to conduct a open space wedding, or we want it by the riverside, or we want a church wedding. Okay, so you make a list of, first you make a list of your things. So you decide on the activities that you have to do. Okay, so this planning will focus on what all activities you need to do to be able to decide on venue. First, you should have clarity on what type of wedding, where do you want to conduct the wedding. Okay, so based on that, you prepare a list of venues, you prepare other things. In planning, we are just deciding what all things we have to do. We don't actually go and, prepare this list. That would be the sprint execution part. Okay. So product roadmap. So we have talked about roadmap. It is a high level view of the product features to support the product vision. A very high level view of the features, when they will be delivered or when they will be available to the customer. Okay, and this is always geared towards the product vision. Okay, that's my product roadmap. It includes release schedule. By the way, product owner owns the roadmap. Okay, product owner owns the roadmap. And he owns and manages, and he creates a list of all the requirements, which is the backlog. Okay, the team and stakeholders contribute both towards the backlog and towards the roadmap. Okay, so what he did, product owner, he is the one person responsible or have the ownership of creating the roadmap and the backlog. And to ensure that this backlog is always in the correct order, means prioritization. And what do we call this? There is a specific word for it. Yes. Product backlog grooming or refinement. Okay. And when you want to get more details about it, you will have to see our other chapter videos. Okay. So product roadmap includes the release schedule. It prioritizes and categorizes the requirements, define backbone, walking skeleton, team contributes, and visually shows the releases and feature sets. Product owner is responsible and it is revisited, and not just annually, depending on when the need comes. Annually it has to be done, but if there is a need to revisit it immediately, it can be done. Okay, agile is all about flexibility. Don't forget, Agile is all about flexibility. We do not fix things. We welcome changes. And we realize that change is the only constant thing. So if there is a latest change in the competitive environment or market environment, I am flexible to revisit my roadmap at any point. Okay. So this is how a roadmap looks like when it is done through story maps. And story maps is covered in our analysis and design chapter. To get full detail about roadmap and story maps, how they are created, what is backbone, what is walking skeleton, please go and refer to the video of analysis and design chapter. Okay, I would encourage you to listen to this video. So a product roadmap looks like this. You know, this is an example of a story map. Okay, story map visually depicts the product roadmap. And what it is showing, that these are the releases. Okay, these are the constituents of my first release. And my first release comprises of 3 iterations, 1, 2, and 3. Okay, in first iteration, I am working on this part. Second iteration, I'm working on this part. And in third iteration, I'm working on this part. Okay. So this also tells me, if my iteration is, let's say, 2 weeks. 2 weeks and 2 weeks. Iteration time does not change. This is fixed. Okay. We decide at the initial stage, what is the duration of iteration that we want to keep? And this is the thing that we do not change. Duration, only the duration. What goes in the iteration, it changes all the time. Okay, that is not an issue. Okay, so that means my release 1 will be delivered after 1.5 months or 6 weeks. So that's how the release planning happens. Okay. So what's the difference between roadmap and backlog? We saw roadmap gives the overall picture of various features, when they will be available, and in which release, which sprint they will be available. Backlog is a requirements document. Okay. This is a strategic document. How the product is likely to grow across several major releases. Okay. What all functionality I'm going to add. Release on release, iteration on iteration. And this is comprehensive list of requirements which will provide value to the customer. So these requirements are planned through roadmap. This gives direction to the product backlog items, and it contains the stories, epics, whose delivery is planned in roadmap. Release planning, who does it? Product owner, Scrum Master, team, key stakeholders, and it could be Agile coach. What is the purpose? Create a release plan depicting the releases, iterations within them, and the tentative timelines. Okay, when it is done, occurs at the beginning of a new project and revisited before every release. So at the beginning of the project, at a high level, I decide on the release plan, and when I'm going to start on that particular release, I do the release planning, which is going to be more granular. Okay, remember, progressive elaboration. Okay, so beginning, we decide at a very, very high level. At release plan time, we elaborate it more. And with every sprint planning, we elaborate it even more. Okay, So output is the release backlog. Iteration planning. So what happens? Meeting opens with product vision and roadmap discussion, discussion on results and velocity of previous iterations, risk, issues, concerns. Then the team picks the highest priority stories and they convert these stories into tasks and estimates. They review and update definition of done, action items, and parking lot is updated. Okay, so what is definition of done? You will see it in subsequent videos. So hold on to your question, remember and note down. It's an important topic. So iteration planning versus release planning. This involves story sizing and conversion to tasks. This is at a high level. Okay. Scheduled development happens at a lower level for short cycles. Here it happens at a higher level for features and iterations. Okay. That's iteration planning versus release planning. So we have seen how we can plan a wedding, using Agile in iterations, how the wedding preparation or in fact buying a house, anything you want to do, you can divide it into smaller components which needs to be worked on, and how you can focus on one component or two components or whatever components in the iterations that you plan to do. So it always helps to plan iteratively in small chunks because you can handle them well. There's less uncertainty, you have more clarity, and you can overall deliver something valuable and concrete. Instead of going all over the place, you can do a better job when you pick up some things, a few things, and deliver them well, because that's what is going to bring value in the smallest time frame. Okay, so with this, we come to the end of our first video on the chapter planning, monitoring, and adapting. And what would you do now? Yes, go ahead and subscribe to our YouTube channel. If you like this video and you feel that we have helped you in your journey for PMI ACP exam prep, go ahead and subscribe to our YouTube channel, because we keep adding interesting videos which will support you to embark on this journey, and soon you will be PMI ACP certified. Yes, and the full course PMI ACP exam prep is available at our website www.eduhubspot.com. Go ahead and join the course. You can also connect with us through services@eduhubspot.com, and this is our mobile number. Okay, with that, oh yes, before you go, I would like you to leave me a comment stating which out of Agile and Waterfall you are using right now, and what would you prefer to use in your project with the reason. Okay, so just a comment saying now, let's say Waterfall, and want to use Agile. Just an example, I don't want you to write this, okay? And reason, why do you think in your project Waterfall is better or Agile is better? Okay, and now you can go to our next video, which is on planning initiation documents. Subscribe here for our new videos, latest videos, and this is my favorite video. Enjoy it. Bye-bye. Happy reading.